Jesus and how he died to save men. The plan of salvation assures us he's coming back again. Are you ready for Jesus to come? Are you faithful in all that you do? Have you fought the good fight? Have you stood for the right? Have others seen Jesus in you? Are you ready to stand in your place? Are you ready to look? Can you look up and say, this is my Lord? Are you ready for Jesus to come? Don't cling to this world and its treasure, this earth, it will soon pass away. Oh, give him your love without measure. He's calling you today. Jesus to come. Are you faithful in all that you do? Do you fight the good fight? Do you stand for the right? Do others see Jesus? Are you ready to stand in your place? Are you ready to look in his face? Can you look up and say, this is my to come.
The following is a special presentation of Soul Cafe Radio. Give me Jesus.
Hello friends, and welcome to Soul Cafe Radio. This is our Friday evening in December studies. Tonight, again, our topic is Give Me Jesus. This is part two, Believing. Last week, we looked at the message of receiving and saw in Luke 2 where the angels met the shepherds in Bethlehem and told them about the baby Jesus. Now, as we pointed out, in order for them to make it to the point where they were, they had to receive that word. But they went further into believing it. We said that we'll be looking at that thought, and this week our chief focus is in that area. Before we get further, we are looking, again, like I said, at part two of Give Me Jesus, the series, and our topic is receiving, believing. I'm going to be getting too confused, so bear with me. At this time, before we pray, we'll have our scripture reading, then we'll pray, and then we'll have a few items of special song, and on the other side, we'll get back with the word and believing.
But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet have believed.
This was John chapter 20, verses 24 to 29. John chapter 20, verses 24 to 29. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your love and kindness towards us. Thank you, Father, for your tender watch here. As we come now to hear your words, I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that your Holy Spirit will just be our teacher, and that everything that transpires in this evening study will be to your name's praise, honor, and glory. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to hear your words, and we know, Lord God, that soon and very soon, this opportunity will be taken away from us. So, Lord, I just cherish the time that we could get into your word and study it right. So now bless your words to our hearts, I pray, and bless the listening audience. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
In the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I come to die, oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, give me Jesus.
In last week's presentation, we looked at Give Me Jesus, receiving. And like we said, we saw in the experience of the shepherds when the angels came to them announcing the birth of Jesus Christ. And in line with last week's theme of receiving, even though, like I mentioned, this probably was the first time in a really long time that actual angels appeared to men, these shepherds, they did not reject what their eyes were seeing and what their ears were hearing. In fact, the Bible makes it clear, and we dwelt quite a bit on that point, of how when they received that word, it impelled them and compelled them to run all the way back into the city just to see what the angels were talking about. Unfortunately, in their case, they freely admitted that seeing was believing. We'll be visiting in a minute another experience of seeing is believing. But the important thing from last week's lesson was the fact that they received, they did not reject. And see, the next logical step, the next phase, naturally, to progress from receiving is to believe. Remember last week we touched a little bit about the Berean Christians? There I go again. Remember what happened last week? That I got the revelation that we weren't dealing with quote unquote converted Christians, but Jews. Over in Thessalonica, you had Paul meeting with a group of they were hard. They were giving Paul a hard time. So much so that Paul had to exit Thessalonica by night and to be spirited away. And he found himself next morning in Berea. And he went into one of the synagogues of the Berean Jews, and the Bible says something very astounding. And the account is taken from Acts 17, 10 and 11. And in 11, the Bible says that the Bereans were more noble than those in Thessalonica, than the Thessalonians. Because what? They received the word with all readiness. And I made a point last week that that's what exactly what we need to do. We might learn something. Because we're so quick to reject and dismiss, we miss out on so many blessings. Another point I had to bring out last week. But the Bible goes on to say that they went back and studied it for themselves, whether those things were so. So again, they received. And the next logical stage in the progression is believing. And so they studied to see where those things were so, and they believed. We now come to the so-called believing Jews, the very ones who gave Paul a hard time in his ministry. But before we get to the Jews, let's turn back and look at our friend Thomas. Again, picking up from verse 24 of John chapter 20, the Bible says, "But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came to them the first time. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger unto the prints of the nails, and thrust my hand unto his side, I will not believe." In other words, the apostle Thomas was saying, seeing is believing. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, Peace be unto you. Then said he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet believe. You know what I always tell people about this passage of scripture? The simple fact that here you have an experience where Thomas made all these good sounding platitudes. I'm not going to believe unless I do A, B, C, X, Y, Z. And then it's Jesus standing before him. And you know what? All of that good talk went out the window. And he just fell on his knees and said, "My Lord and my God," simply because he beheld. He saw. And for him, seeing was believing. But Jesus said, "Let it not always be the case, because I'm about to be taken away." And he pronounced the blessing on all those who, not seeing, yet believe. I pray, beloved, that that is our desire, that is our condition, that is our state of life. We live 2,000 years removed from that situation over there in Jerusalem. We want to see how important it is for us to, with the eyes of faith, turn our eyes upon Jesus and look full.
Glory and grace.
That's actually a tall order, if you stop to think about it. Looking in the face of Jesus, only possible by faith. The Bible says in Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. 2,000 years ago, men and women, boys and girls, had the golden opportunity to look literally in the face of God. A pause just for dramatic effect, if you don't mind. Because that is indeed a sobering thought to take in. And yet, the record is clear that he was rejected by the masses. He was rejected by the very class he came to save. And 2,000 years later, we're asked, as the song said, to turn our eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face. Again, it takes faith. Faith to believe. But we can't just leave it there, beloved, because if it was just left there by itself, then of all men, we'd be most miserable. But we're given a promise. It's a blessing. It says, blessed are they who have not seen and yet believe. It's not, and I tell you, it's strange, right? But those people who actually saw him, who touched him, who had opportunity to be with him on a daily basis, who came so very close as mortals could come to heaven. Friends, you and I have a distinct advantage over them. Yes, we do. You want to know what that is? According to Hebrews 11, it is our believing faith that would usher in and bring down the curtain on the controversy and cause those who believed back then to arise in the first resurrection. Yes, I know you didn't think about it that way, but my friends, this is the ultimate goal of your believing. Because, like I said, it's not just to stay static. It's not just to stay passive, I mean, and not just do anything, it's active, it's dynamic. So when I say I believe, it's not just something I say intellectually, it actually becomes an experience. Notice what the Bible says, again looking at Romans chapter 10, but this time a little bit above in verses 9 and 10. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth and believe in thy heart the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved. Thou art saved. Excuse me. Believing is key. Not just because you say it out of your mouth, we're talking about believing. In fact, the Bible addresses that very point. I tell you, friends, the more and more you get into the scriptures, the more and more, if you're not being conducted by the Spirit, the more you lose your mind. Allow me to explain. Over here in John chapter 3, the Bible says, and we'll get to it in a minute in detail, but the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, here we go, believe it, should not perish but have everlasting life. We're told that it is important that confession needs to be made. But over here, we have another word that says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom. So, clearly, believing just doesn't mean that I say I believe. There's got to be more to it. Believing, like I said, is not just some stationary, some passive notion. It's active, it's dynamic. And in fact, like I said, it will be the thing that brings down the curtain on the controversy. Believing. when I cry out for Jesus, it's not only because I have received the word with all readiness. It's because as a student of the word, I've been studying, I've been praying, and I've been daily allowing him to exercise his will in my life. And so therefore, believing translates to more than just an intellectual experience. It becomes an actual experience. Because it's not just about confessing with your mouth, it's also believing with the heart. And that's just a connotation that goes deeper than the mind. It's not just superficial, it's not just intellectual. It's an actual living experience. If thou wilt confess with your mouth and believe with your heart, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says, you're safe. Now, as we said, we turn to John chapter 3 and verse 16. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For the next few moments, that's where our mind is going to dwell. Not so much in John chapter 3 and verse 16, but on that thought of believing. You see, one of the key components in John chapter 3 and verse 16 is that it says to believe. It never mentions you going on any errands to prove yourself. It never mentions you doing some great endeavor to show to God that, yes, I am converted, I am now a Christian. Friends, it simply says, if you believe. And again, we're not just talking intellectual. We're not just talking in the head and knowing that there was a person named Jesus some 2,000 years ago, knowing the basic mechanisms of Genesis to Revelation, able to recite scripture at the drop of a hat. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about an actual living experience that Hebrews 11 talks about, where it mentions in those men and women, boys and girls of bygone ages, where, for instance, when one's fate made him not move and be firm as a mountain, another person's fate told him to get up and go. When one person's fate had him bowing down and praying, another person's fate had him standing tall and rejecting. You see, beloved, out there, I'm so serious about this. Can I pause a minute and just share something from my heart? I said to someone just this week alone that as a Christian, in your witnessing, one of the things that you want to do is make sure that when you leave a person and that you're having a discussion with, that them thinking and wanting more. You never want to have that person reject you because you're being because you're being offensive, or I think I wanted to say objectionable. If anything, the onus is on them, but you would have caused them to hear from God's word. And just because they took the time to receive what you were saying, chances are belief will come. And here in John chapter 3 and verse 16, the Bible is crystal clear. Again, it's not about some head knowledge. It's not about what you know. It's about who you know. And this faith, this believing process, I'm telling you, over the course of thousands and thousands of years, secular army generals have tried to replicate it in the hearts of the subordinates. How Christian men and women, boys and girls, were willing to die for a cause that these people out there in the world barely have a concept of true belief. Again, in John chapter 3 and verse 16, the Bible is also clear. And this is what I want to add. It says, "For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes shall not perish, but have eternal life, but have everlasting life." You see, friends, that's what believing ultimately does. Ultimately, it leads you into a progressive work where you want to change your whole life completely. Like one of our songs said, "Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you." And all along, people were thinking that John 3:16 was just some simple text found in the Bible. But it was not. It is one of the most profound passages of this or any other scripture, because it speaks profoundly to the human condition. Again, allow me to explain. You tell a man, "If you do me this one thing, climb Mount Everest and then climb the other 6 tallest peaks in the world. And after you get done with that, cross the longest lake, the strongest river, battle lions and tigers and bears. And at the end of all that, you'll be rewarded with wealth and riches beyond your wildest dreams." You know what, my friends? For the temporary treasures, I dare tell you the majority will undertake these endeavors. And you know what's even funnier, dear friends? Say that person has no arms or no legs. You best believe that because we're so hardwired to accept these challenges, even he, my beloved, even he would dare to take on that challenge. But the sad thing is, when God is not calling us, when no one is calling us to throw up our hands in the air and say, "I surrender," when no one is making that appeal, when it's easy to say, "I can do this and I can do that," but just enter into that period of who here believes in Jesus and wants to take this stand with him. Life is good until you come across the notion of believing in Jesus. Because you know what? This is what your senses tell you. I have taste buds, and I can taste when something is sweet or sour or bitter. Sweet, sour, bitter, salty. And my hands could touch, my ears could hear, my eyes could see. But this whole concept of believing, wow, that's where faith comes in. To believe in the unseen, the invisible. But not many people take up that challenge. Even that person with no limbs does not even come to Jesus for peace of mind. Because for the majority of people, climbing the highest mountains and crossing the deeper seas is more tangible than believing in a God that they can't see. But friends, I want to speak to those who have not completely rejected the gospel invitation message. Because you have taken the time to at least hear a person out. I promise you by the grace of God, somewhere down the road, it may not be manifested tonight, it may not be manifested tomorrow, nor the next day, or the day after that. But I guarantee you, my beloved, that something said to you will prick. And you will want to seek out anyone who has information about what you're talking about, because at that point you'll be ready, not just to receive, because you're receiving, but to fully believe. The Ethiopian eunuch, as he was riding in his chariot one day, he came across a visitor who was miraculously transported to where he was. I said this last week, and I'll say it again. We ought to strike while the iron's hot. And we cannot afford to miss these golden opportunities. To you as an individual, you may not have the opportunity to be in a chariot and someone comes to you. You may not be on the side of a road one day and angels appear to you and tell you mysteries. But I pray that you will have the heart that Jesus said that those of us who have not seen would have, that you'd believe. One of the greatest things that you can give yourself is the blessings of John chapter 3 and verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave. And though many questioned, and I mean many, many, are starting to question a lot of things. But even though the many questioned, beloved, it's a prayer in my heart that you stand as a bulwark against those who would seek to tear down the truth as it is in Jesus and say, oh no, that's not the case. There's no such thing as Jesus. He never existed. Stand firm for the truth that you know is right. Be an overcomer this night, my dear friends. I want to talk to you for a minute about the experience of Thomas, and then we'll close. Let's go back and examine something that we saw in Thomas's experience. Notice what he said. Notice what Thomas said as he spoke boldly to the other disciples. These are his words. John chapter 20, picking right back up in verse 24. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. In verse 25, then the other disciples, they said, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, this is what I wanted to point out to you. He said, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. In the book of Zechariah, the Bible gives an accounting of a group of people who will say to one with wounds in his hands, how did you come by these wounds? And he'll say to them, I got them in the house of my friends. Beloved, this is a case of many, many people coming to the kingdom. Not ever heard the gospel story explained like that before. But because Jesus is a sin-pardoned Savior, and that person would have lived up to all the light that they knew, They believed and did not waver. Heaven became the eternal reality. Friend, I'm talking to you on this side of that experience. Right now you have opportunity to know the gospel. You have great opportunity to study God's word for yourself, to know what it says for yourself. I pray by the grace of God that you'll heed the warning. Take it seriously. Let's no longer play games with what we have, because the next stage and next week's study is vitally important. Once you believe, once you receive, and then believe, then the next natural phase in the progression is impartation. And we'll talk about that in detail come next week as we continue through of me, Jesus, imparting. But for now, I just want to close tonight's study again with the verse of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The Bible tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. If thou wilt confess with thy mouth and believe in thy heart the Lord Jesus Christ, thou art saved. Friend, it's just that easy, but so many people make it difficult. Oh friends, dare to believe. That's what I want to leave you with this night. Dare to believe. Don't just take receiving and think that you could run all the way to the goal line with just receiving, because it'll only take you so far. Like Jesus said to Thomas, my friends, be not faithless and believe. But again, but alas, the only way that any believing work can be done and accomplished on our behalf is if we turn our eyes towards Jesus and look full in his wonderful face. Only Christ could accomplish in us and for us the work that's needed. I solicit to you, dear beloved, that in the light of his glory and grace, in the full light of the revelation that Jesus Christ is Lord, the things of this world indeed will grow strangely dim. And you won't even need to say, except I, for just one glimpse of the Savior, my friends. You'll find his arms open wide. But your task just now, dear friend, is to turn and live. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
No light in the darkness you see. Grace.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for being with us on this program today. May you continue to bless your words to our hearts, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Dear friends, I'll see you next week as we continue in part 3. Give me Jesus, impartation. Until next time, God bless.